Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here with Professor Michele Parrinello. And I'm joined also by my colleague, Professor Sandro Scandolo. And we will be talking to Michele. Michele, as you know, received the Dirac Medal from ICTP in 2009, together with Roberto Car. And I'll read the citation. It was given for the joint contributions of Roberto Car and Michele Parrinello in developing the ab initio simulation methods, in which they employed elegantly and imaginatively the quantum mechanical density functional method for the calculation of the electronic properties of matter with molecular dynamics method for the Newtonian simulation of atomic motions. And I think their famous 1985 paper is titled Unified Approach to Molecular Dynamics and Density Functional Theory. And as I understand, some of this work was done here in Trieste, so it's particularly opportune that we have Michele with us. But Michele also has a very close affiliation with ICTP. He was the member of the Scientific Council of ICTP for many years, and it has been a very valuable contributions and his advice on many matters of scientific importance to ICTP. And as I understand from him, he also spent in the early years when the condensed matter section at ICTP was being developed at the time of Salam. So it would be nice to have a conversation about this. And Professor Scandolo, he is the head of our research at ICTP, but he also works in a area of physics close to doing the ab initio calculations. So maybe we can start with a question about the work that led to the Dirac Medal. So just to explain it to maybe the not so lay audience, but it's mostly the physics audience, but still somebody who doesn't work in this field like myself. It seems to me that your work was kind of a generalization of, let's say, related to the Born-Oppenheimer method, which one studies in high school, I think, when you study quantum mechanics, and this density functional. So maybe you can you say something?
I mean, the theoretical justification for what we do in the end boils down to the Born-Oppenheimer principle that allows you kind of separate, decouple the motion of the ions of the nuclei from the motion of the electron. So that makes, of course, the calculation very much easier. Otherwise, one would have to solve the time-dependent Schrödinger equation if you want to study the motion of atoms, which is really not yet possible. It's only possible for a very tiny system. So that's the first. The other important theoretical tool is density functional theory, which was developed at the time, and by which you can make relatively accurate electronic structure calculation. So in the Born-Oppenheimer principle, you need the energy of the ground state, and you can calculate through this theory in a computational efficient manner without losing too much accuracy. So and the other things, we use molecular dynamics, so to describe the motion of the nuclei. And so we put together these two things, which were previously were really two different communities that couldn't talk to one another. Well, the electronic structure people, for whom the world was a frozen world, so nothing moved, and or just they oscillate around the equilibrium position, and molecular dynamics, where really you take the opposite view, where everything moves, liquid, so you can sort of all kind of dynamical and many body complex system. So we put together, and this marriage has been very profitable because one can study the chemical processes, breaking bonds, transition between metallic to non-metallic, difficult interaction, which are difficult to model with some empirical potential. So that has been, I would say, practical and also cultural step forward, because these two communities that they were orthogonal, now that sort of come together, and I think we both profited from this.
Now, I remember an eminent member of our community at the time saying that, I won't say the name, by the way, but he said that it was clear to him that this method would have revolutionized the field, and in fact it did. But it wasn't really clear to him, and it took him several years to understand why it was working. So my question for you is that, was it actually clear to you that the method would have been working so well, and also, of course, that it would have revolutionized the field as it did?
Oh, no, at the time we just did it for fun. We had not aware, there was a lot of excitement because we saw things happening. The initial, we had a very tiny system to simulate, 8 atoms of silicon that just went forth and back and so on, with forces calculated from DFT. And there was excitement. So that tells you how backward the situation was. We were so very excited to see this happening, and the possibility in our mind were being opened by this new way of doing things. But that it was going to have such a great resonance, I was not. In fact, I remember in those days, people, there was no electronic post, no PDF being sent around, so you had to do you make photocopies of the thing, and or even photocopies were. Not like today, they were produced on stinking material. I don't know if people are old enough, they might remember. And so we were traveling around. So we were two unknown small guys from a peripheral university. And so we became celebrity kind of thing. We were invited all over the place, and I went around and saw people studying our paper. So it was quite an elating thing, which I didn't expect. And I think neither Robert, luckily, didn't go to our head, neither in the case to Roberto nor in mine. And I think we kept our feet on the ground and tried to develop further things.
That was also the time in which the first big supercomputer started.
Oh, yeah, so that I have to tell you. That's there are random forces that govern your thing. So at the time, it was bought here a computer, which I will not mention because it was one of the major disasters of technology. It was really not adequate. And we had discovered our method. We needed to upgrade the things. What we had here was not enough. Actually, incidentally, so there were punctures in the hall, now the Leonardo building. It's not like it is all, but we would work, because there was no other possibility, with punctures, I don't know whether young people don't know what they are, but you use cards to program the thing, you need this puncture. Well, in the hall of the Leonardo building, and people were coming forth and back, and we were working along. In front. So it was all very romantic and and primitive. But miracles happen. Miracles do happen. So Cineca, which is the main computer center at the time, was the main computer center, still is the main computer center in Italy, decided to upgrade its machine and bought the first Cray. So Cray was like getting a Ferrari. Huh? Yes. You go off with a 500 to a Ferrari, all of a sudden. And there was a very courageous initiative from the part of Cineca, because it was not clear whether there was community that could be able to use it, because to drive a Ferrari, it's not, you crash immediately if you go, they give you lessons to drive a Ferrari. I understand that, I have no intention to buy a Ferrari, but so they, our code was very good for that, for the architecture of the clay, because it was what is called then the vectorial machine. In modern terms, it's very similar to the GPUs that are used now. And our code was very easy to parallelizable, adaptable to the machine. We get a little help, okay? And so we could scale up our calculation from 8 atoms. We went to 32 atoms, which was the scaling of the algorithm is cubic. So it's not trivial. Not trivial. There was still one problem left, was communication. Because we had to go through the telephone number. The computer was in Bologna, and we were here. Renting a fast line from Telecom was outrageously expensive. So the people in Bologna, what they did very creatively, they were involved in a project of data communication through satellites. Wow. And so they made Trieste as part of this experiment.
Very good.
And so in one of the buildings, was called in the valley, it's called Bella Vista Building, in the garden there was a big parabola, and so which would send our code, the Parrinello code, up to the satellite and down to Bologna.
I see.
And so there were these two things that allow us to make competitive calculation relative to the rest of the world. Without this intervention.
Let me ask you about this. I mean, this question. Cinquecento going to a Ferrari, you know.
Yes.
Also, just to explain it to myself and to the audience. Mm. So if I understand, the Born Oppenheimer, back to, was to understand, you know, you hold the atomic positions essentially fixed, and then you solve the fast degrees of freedom of the electrons, and then that allows you to study
calculate the forces,
and then it allows you to study like the vibration and modes,
and then you move whatever diffusion whatever,
and that was quite successful in the early days of quantum mechanics in studying
certain
properties.
Yeah, that's a lot of calculation
could be done.
I mean, also standard chemical calculation. If they want to calculate vibration, they use, they make appear to, of course, in many cases, it's valid, they can do a lot of good physics, but there are situations where not, what's called non-adiabatic, which is a violation of the Born-Oppenheimer principle, take place, and that's, the world becomes more difficult.
Interesting. And the other component is this density functional theory.
Yes, that's
whose
right.
Whose precedent is like a bit like Thomas Fermi theory.
That's correct.
You approximate.
It's the modern version of Thomas Fermi.
You approximate.
Actually, I should say Fermi, because there's a dispute that Thomas, it's an imperialistic
is that right?
Intervention.
I see. Okay. So, you know, that also had its own success in maybe explaining the atomic levels and so on.
But that was really very poor, if you want.
Yeah.
You get the simple things, understanding Thomas Fermi. So,
you know, that was like the Cinquecento. Now I'm coming to
It was like a bullock cart. Thomas Fermi, it was, I would say, before the Cinquecento.
The bicycle. It was the bicycle.
I mean, the horse. Carriage or something like
exactly.
that. It's really not adequate.
So my question is that I want to come to is that now in the 21st century we really have very sophisticated, I mean, even for a physicist who's not working in the field, it looks pretty spectacular that you can almost play God in that you can solve the Schrodinger's equation on the design material properties in a rather precise way.
Yeah.
So can you sort of give some examples, or you know, how do you place the level of accuracy and predictability in the current methods? Where do we stand? How big molecules can we design? Things like that. I mean.
It's a question to which one cannot give simple answer. I mean, there are situations in which the electronic interaction are relatively simple, and if you so organic chemists in general, okay, or inorganic chemists and so on, the interactions are relatively simple from the chemical point of view, and a theory like the DFT works very well. And if you are under the condition in which a Born-Oppenheimer holds, then they do a good job. In fact, that's why it became very popular, DFT at the time, because they could calculate. So there are lots of systems for which density functional theory works rather well. And for this, it depends. I mean, I was saying, in fact, that there was the demonstration of the validity of DFT for the first time. That was before Car Parrinello. Then one could calculate the equation of state of silicon with accuracy of few percent. And it depends on which property you look at, but I would say 5%, 1%. And so you for this class of materials, and in the Born-Oppenheimer limit, the calculation is fairly accurate, And they are getting more and more accurate because the DFT becomes better. Okay, there are theoretical developments that I will not go into it. But the world is not all simple. It's like people. There are people that are easy to deal with, and people. there's the highly correlated systems for which theory have struggled with it, ITC, and so on. There are more complicated, and of course, they're very interesting. Mm-hmm. But the electronic structure part is not very well understood, and there are not practical way of amending the existing theory to a level of computational ease by which you can do it over and over and over again. You can do single point calculation, which are very expensive, and I mean the chemists have a couple cluster which they consider like gold, but then a couple cluster is only small molecules. If you want to go to large system, there is no solution for difficult system. Yes, I would say.
Now, I wanted to ask you something about, I mean, this new developments in the field, and of course I'm referring to machine learning, artificial intelligence, and which of course these are techniques that are now revolutionizing, I mean, several fields, but including the field of atomistic simulations. And you've been a pioneer in this respect. I mean, you've done wonderful work in developing force fields based on neural network methods. I remember your papers in the mid-2000s, so on and so forth. I mean, but where do you think this is going? I mean, where do you see the impact of machine learning methods in the field of atomistic simulations in the future? Where do you think they will have the highest impact?
Okay, I think machine learning for me, it has been a blessing, okay? Because I can do now what we were hoping to be able to do when we started with Roberto, but for much larger system, for more complicated issues, and so on. So it has been a really enabling technology. And the way we use now is one, to build potential, so you do a number of these expensive calculations, and on this data you generate an interpolatory function based on machine learning things. The other area is so you have a very complicated system, you want to understand things, and so you want to express things in a simple way, and so having, using, in physics, order parameters. Let me put this way, to simplify the issue, discovering this order parameter. And if you discover the order parameter, then you can use tricks to speed up the calculation, because that's another important issue, because in present-day machines, the power comes from parallel. But if you think time evolution is not, it's serial, one step of the other. And so there is time scale is very important, and it's a gap between what you can do and what you would like to do, or what you need to do, should I say, that cannot bridge by technology. And so you develop, and in this area, that's an area where machine learning can play and will play, is playing and will play a role, also to build simplified model. I mean, that's all. In the end, I do a lot of chemistry, but I was born as a physicist, so I tend to have a reductionistic approach to things. I would like to see, say, the things expressed in a simple, elegant way. Complex phenomena bring it to something simple, and that will help. The other area will be coarse graining, I would say. So when you have a system, you treat it with different degrees of accuracy. So that's, these are areas where help, but one would like to maintain, I would like to maintain always the contact between physics and what the machine learning says, because very often they use it as a black box, and that's that I don't like. That's not our job, but that's an with all due respect, I think as engineers, it's a great class of individual that make our life simpler. Sorry, the greatest of respect, but that's not my job. My job is to understand, and that's, I want to stick to that. And so one important duty of people like me, and like us, I think also Sandra, you, I assume, are in this class, is to understand. And so change machine learning, or adapt machine learning, so as to you understand what goes on and not simply compute, because that's...
I think that's a very important point, is that machine learning can only give you some pattern, but you want to understand the underlying layer of,
they say interpretable machine learning.
Right.
Interpretable by so we have a project at IIT, which I don't know whether it's going to be a plan. They say teaching physics to computers.
No, but I think there is an issue. Yeah, with machine learning, you know, what constitutes understanding, right?
Yeah, that's right.
If I can predict the weather outside,
sure.
Is that understanding or is that just a prediction?
No, absolutely, because you want to abstract it, generalize, and so on. I like machine learning, I use it a lot, but suppose you were to do the Fraunhofer experiment. Millions of things. You can predict that if you vary the size of the slip, that you get a certain pattern. But we will now discover quantum mechanics.
Yes.
The machine could, from this data, could predict you what goes on, but will never come up. I mean, I don't think. Maybe, I mean, machine intelligent people, they are clever. So I wouldn't say that it will never possible, but at the present thing, I don't see that happening easily.
Okay, let's maybe now move to the your other aspect of your association with ICTP.
Okay. And
once, of course, was physics, but you have also been associated with us in the Scientific Council.
Yes.
Also, as I understand the. Salam wanted to develop a condensed matter section. The Scientific Council advised him to do that.
Yeah.
and you were among the first people who were at the University of Trieste. Who really helped.
So maybe you want to comment.
You bring
me back to my youth. and so the way I know this story, that's Salama wanted to expand ICTP with activities that were mostly focused on high energy investigations to condensed matter. And all they looked around for possible candidate, and they spotted the Eriotos Attic. Well, it was a lucky, I mean, very, very wise choice, as a person that could do the job. And Elio thought that it would be too hard a job for him alone. And so he said, okay, so I come if a colleague, older colleague of mine, Mario Tosi, Mario Tosi, would also come, because he was somebody with experience in dealing with the university and so on, with managerial thing. And then, I always would be grateful to Elio. At the time I was at the University of Messina, not certainly the center of the world, but Elio visited Messina because he had friends and so on. We started talking science, we became immediately friends, started collaborating. So he spotted in me the possibility of that I could become, could be of help to him and to the situation. And he put my name and said, I want Tosi. I was an important person in at ICTP in those days, and my humble self, say with fake humility, to come along, and then I will be always grateful to him. And I think it's very generous. It is one of the characters of Elio that he has no envy. And he didn't, so he might have normal person would say, oh, this can put a shade, cast a shade on what I do and so on. But he knows that his generosity is without the limits, I would say. And I think I'm great. In many other occasions, he's shown the same amount.
So you came to the University of Trieste, and then?
Yes, so I got both he and I got a position at the University of Trieste, mm-hmm. and the Institute of Theoretical Physics of the University of Trieste is located in this very same building.
Yes.
And so we had a wonderful room overlooking the strait and the blue skies and the sea. It was a real idyllic. We were sharing a room and we were much younger. We had a great time together.
Now, I mean, after many, many years, and thanks to your, you know, crucial contributions to the field, especially here at the STP, there is now a huge community of scientists, as you probably know. I mean, working in methods connected with, you know, electronic structure, molecular dynamics, and so on, globally, but especially in places that are the main, you know, target for ICTP. Now, we've been talking about the need for large computational infrastructure, and of course, in these places, this is really sometimes a challenge. On the other hand, there are people like you who have been pioneering methods to, you know, make calculations more efficient. So, is there anything you would like to say to this community of people who sometimes struggle just to get, you know, basic computational resources, but still would like to, you know, pursue research in this field?
The powerful computer are important, but powerful brain is more important. And there are ways, of course, I mean, eventually you will need some more, there should be a minimum level, but the technology advances. So in two ways. One is the top scale, which for developing countries will be difficult to reach, but also the lower scale, where you can get reasonable computer power with a limited amount of resources. I think that's, that should not be stopped by that, and then they can come here and, yes, in fact, they can get help to access if the project it deserves. And in this way, I think that I always liked ICTP and this mission and this multicultural environment, and that's I think it's been, it does a great job, and I think this is like my home kind of thing.
In fact, I mean, going following up on what Sandro was saying, I mean, as you know, you are on the Scientific Council. We are trying to build this international consortium for scientific computing.
To make these methods
available more widely around the world. So maybe you can comment on what you think are the what you think of this idea and what you think are the challenges and how perhaps ICTP can organize itself in this direction.
Okay, so.
I should tell you that we've had some very good, for example, we now recently signed an MOU with South Africa, National Center for Theoretical. I think this kind of a synergy is beginning to grow.
So
we really want to take it to the next level.
I think that's a very good thing. So it's a necessary thing to do. And yes, I would encourage you to that one could be. Think of since this is a very kind of I don't say humanitarian, altruistic, or it's not really altruistic. I mean, it's egoistic because
it helps.
If you cannot be happy if your neighbor is destitute. It's a non-equilibrium situation. So it's also in our own interest to balance the opportunities in the world also. So maybe one can, I'm just throwing this thing, one can ask Bill Gates or Amazon or things to help with the practicalities of other companies of this global nature to help with this endeavor.
Okay, good point. We should actually, I would certainly like to get your views more. We will discuss this afterwards.
Okay.
We are thinking quite seriously about this initiative, and you are certainly one of the people who can advise us very well on this. So it was a pleasure, Michele, to be with you.
Like me, I had, going back to your younger years is always pleasant.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.